My name is Robin Kowalski, and I'm the chair of Lion Legacy, one of the sponsors of the Behind the Mask series, along with Dryden High School. I ask that you please silence your cell phones if you have not done so already. Tonight, I'm pleased to welcome my friend, Stephanie O'Leary, to share her story, From Hopeless to Empowered, How Recovery from Alcoholism Saved My Life.
Can you give me a second here? So, thank you for coming, first of all, so much. My name is Steph O'Leary, and I'm here to talk to you about my journey through alcoholism. And basically, I'm going to talk a little bit about my life, like my childhood, just a little bit to give you some background, what it was like, what happened to me, and what my life is like now that I'm in recovery. My sobriety date, I'm going to just mention now, is August 22nd, 2012. And I started trying to stop drinking in November of 2006. So do the math, there's some years in there. To start, just a little bit about how I grew up, my family. I'm the oldest of three. I'm a younger brother and sister. My mom and my stepfather raised me. And my biological father, although I never met him, I'm told he was an alcoholic. And I believe that even though he was sober when he died as a result of lifelong alcoholism. So what I've learned is that I'm already predisposed to this disease, just starting out. And I didn't grow up around drinking. My parents hardly ever drank. Which some people are surprised by, I'm surprised by. But I had some pretty tragic things happen to me as a pretty young child that kind of contributed to me turning to something to not feel how I felt. And I'm just gonna say, first of all, that I'm really nervous. I'm talking about hard stuff, so if I need a little break here, just bear with me. I don't have waterproof mascara and I can't walk in these heels either, so. I can't make any promises on what's going down here, so. Things for the first 3 years were pretty normal, other than my mom got sick at a really young age with a disease called multiple sclerosis. I was probably 7 or 8 years old, and at that time, my family had to move out into the boondocks, now where I love, and my family built stepfather built a little tiny house that we called the Little House on the Prairie House, because that's how it was. And that house had no electric or running water for 3 years. We had an outhouse the whole bit. But to be quite honest, I remember that time being like the happiest time of my childhood. I'm sure my mom didn't think so, but it was really just very happy and everything was pretty calm. Unfortunately, my mom did get sick, kind of slowly, and eventually ended up in a wheelchair. Also during that time, they did eventually build a different home, so we didn't live with an outhouse forever. What happened at that time as well was I started to be sexually abused by my stepfather. And that happened for quite a few years. And during my mom getting sick. I kind of had turned to him just because I didn't have my mom anymore and I needed my dad. So we were spending a lot of time together, and it was very confusing to me. I didn't understand what was going on. I was really young, and the whole thing was just really confusing. I don't know any other way to describe it. I didn't tell anybody for a really long time, and it continued pretty much on a daily basis for a really, really long time, for several years. I don't remember the exact ages, but at some point I had enough. And we got in a fight about something one day, and I finally decided that I was going to tell my mom what was going on, because I couldn't deal with it anymore. And I did. I told her. And nobody did anything. I went and stayed with my grandparents for one night, and I remember my family, not my whole family, my mom, my dad, and I, went to one family counseling session where I was able to talk a little bit. And basically, I remember the counselor saying that the explanation was that my mom had gotten ill, and I had assumed the motherly role in the family, and it was very confusing for everyone. And that made absolutely no sense to me. But when we got home, I was told that I wasn't supposed to talk about it anymore, and we went right back to life, just the way it had been before. And I spent a lot of time just pretending like things were okay. I mean, I didn't really have any choice. I was kind of like in a survival mode at that point. And it kind of sort of worked for a while. I should also say that there was quite a bit of physical abuse after that stuff. The sexual abuse did stop. But then I was just kind of like, and I antagonized it. I wanted to make him angry. But what I've learned through getting sober, what happened to me through that whole process was, it basically told me that I was nothing, that I didn't matter, that I was a piece of garbage, that nobody loved me, and I kind of molded into that without even realizing. And I just was a really sad, lonely, afraid kid. I was always put on a pretty face, I guess, for the most part, or thought I was, and just kind of coasted along. But I definitely was always afraid of what was going to happen. Home was never calm, and he was very controlling. He was mean to my mom. Like, it was just not a happy place at all. And I don't really need to go into any more detail than that. It is what it is. But I do remember, I think I was 17 or 18 before I had my first drink, which is a lot later than a lot of my friends that are in recovery. But I do remember that the first time, I remember it like it was yesterday. And I think someone actually in this room was probably with me. And it was fun at the time, but I know now that I drank alcoholically the very first time I drank. I drank as fast as possible, and I blacked out the first time. And I didn't even know what a blackout was until I got into recovery. But it's not normal. Like, just so you know, it's not a normal thing that people do. And, but I remember the first sips, I lost all of that insecurity. I felt prettier. I felt funnier. I felt somewhat comfortable in my own skin for the very first time in my whole life. And the goal after that was to do that as much as possible, as much as possible, as often as possible. And that's pretty much what I did. I thought I kept it together. Like, I actually showed up for my job for quite a few years, most of the time. And it's funny to me that several people that are here tonight said to me that they had no idea that I was doing, that I was feeling the way that I was feeling, and I was struggling so much with alcohol. And that's just crazy to me, because it was just, I don't even know. Maybe even my own husband didn't even really know back then. But I did spend an awful lot of time trying to make everything look good on the outside and make people think that I was okay, make myself think I was okay, and I wasn't. The next few years, I just kind of did that. I was what I call maybe a weekend warrior. Like, I would go to work all the time, but on the weekends, I was pretty much drunk from Friday to Sunday. and then I would barely get my shit together so I could, you know, get another work weekend. And but my drinking was always excessive. I was always the girl taking her clothes off. I was always the girl passing out. I was always the girl that was inappropriate and not doing what people do when they drink normally. Had a child, like got married again. But all through that time, my drinking was never normal. A lot of people protected me. I should have been in jail so many times. And people just kept basically enabling me and getting me out of trouble. And I'm thankful, but it just kind of kept me out there for a really long time. Sometime in my middle 30s, it all turned. And what I've learned about alcoholism is that it's a progressive disease. First of all, I should say that it's a disease, and I didn't know that. Like, I thought I was just a really horrible, awful person that had no willpower, no morals, like, just that I was just terrible, because that's what I thought ever since I was a young kid, that I was just not a good person, or people would have helped. And I also learned that it's a progressive disease, so gradually, over time, for most people, if you're an alcoholic, it gets worse. And I didn't think that was me, but it did. It finally happened. And I started drinking pretty much all day. Definitely all night, but the minute I got out of work, I was scheming when I could get a drink. Sorry for all the ums. I'm thinking. There we go. So, yeah, it just gradually started getting worse. Getting pulled over all the time, never getting in trouble. Like, I could go on and on about the stories, you know, it doesn't really matter. But finally, I was urged by my family, and I agreed that I should go to rehab. And I didn't want to go, but I remember thinking that it was probably a good idea. And I certainly wanted to get everybody off my back, so I could just go back to drinking. And I thought that if I just took that time and sobered up a little bit and got myself under control, then I could just go back to my life. And at that time, my life was drinking. All of my friends drank. Like, every activity was drinking. Everywhere we went was drinking. Everywhere we hung out was drinking. We drank before, we drank after, we drank during. Everything. I couldn't see myself not living in that life. I went to rehab, though, and I'm always good at that stuff. Like, I want to follow the rules in general, and I was like, I call myself like a rehab poster child, because I was happy there, oddly enough. And I think the reason is because I felt really safe there. I knew I wasn't going to drink. I knew I wasn't going to be hurting anybody, myself, and people that I love. And I was getting to talk about things that I hadn't really gotten to talk about my whole life. And but I was more worried about coming home to my son and my husband and getting back to my job and just picking right back up where I left off. And luckily for me, I was able to put a little time together after that. And all that did for me was, after about a year, a little more than a year, I remember thinking that I couldn't possibly be an alcoholic. There's no possible way. Like, people that are alcoholics don't just stop drinking like that for a whole year. And I, like, could be pretty convincing. And I managed to convince someone in my life that I should start drinking again. And so I did. And I can't even begin to describe the next 5 or 6 years of my life. I thought I had been miserable before. Like, I had no idea where alcohol could take me. I had no idea. The short version is 4 rehabs. I probably was seen at Cuba Medical Center, I'm not exaggerating, probably 50 times. I checked in for detox, and I'm not exaggerating. Those people hate me. If I probably walked in today, they would still know my face and be like, whoa, really? Like, I was there so much. just couldn't keep a job. I just wouldn't go. I would just not show up. My son would come home from school every day, and I would hear him running up the stairs because he would be wondering if I was going to be alive or not. Because I was drinking around the clock then when I was drinking. So what I would do at that point was I would drink really heavily for a couple of weeks, like heavily. And then I would try again. I would try to stop again. And but the times that it was bad when I was drinking, I was down and out. Like, I wasn't out in a bar socializing. I was buying as much alcohol as possible, and I was hiding in my room. I was closing the shades, and I was drinking as fast as possible to pass out. And then when I would wake up, I would do that again. And I'm talking like a 12-pack in an hour. And I would do that repeatedly, over and over and over again, until my body literally could not move. Like, literally, I couldn't even get up to walk to the bathroom. And I would be like, I gotta try this again. And I stopped going to the hospital for help, because at the end, I mean, they just didn't want to see me. They weren't helping me really either. They were just letting me sleep in a bed there until I sobered up. So I went through some pretty horrible detoxes at home alone, like a lot of them. And when I say the disease is progressive, like, I wasn't just a little bit shaky. Like, you see a lot of people that drink too much, they're just a little shaky. No, I had seizures. I had hallucinations where I would see things that weren't there, on the walls, on the floor, and my whole entire body would shake so bad that I couldn't walk for a couple days. And there were also three occasions that I tried to take my own life. Sorry. Couldn't stop, and I didn't want to live that way before. Good news is it didn't work. Here I am, thank God. And the other good news is that I was fortunate enough during one of my trips to rehab vacation. That I found I was exposed to a recovery fellowship there. And I'm trying to be very careful about how I talk about this, but it's very, very important because it's what saved my life. Like, all of the treatment, all of the rehab, the inpatient, outpatient, all of it, like, I learned a lot of knowledge about it. But I didn't get to talk to other people like me. And in this fellowship, I did. And I learned for the first time in my whole entire life that I wasn't alone. That there were other people that were living like I was. And that had found a solution and a way out and were living happy lives. And I wanted that. And although I didn't walk in there and was able to stop immediately, I knew there was something there. I knew there was something that could help me. I knew there was something there that I needed and I wanted. So every time I sobered up, I ended up back there, miraculously, time after time after time. And that amazing group of people, a lot of who are here tonight, never judged me. I was judged my whole life, like, by what I did. And these people didn't, because they were like me. And every single time, they said, "We're glad you're here. Welcome back. You're going to try this again. And maybe you'll listen to us this time and follow the suggestions." But there was never any judgment at all. It was all love and understanding. And that's what really, really helped me finally get this. And besides learning that I wasn't alone, I learned that my way doesn't work. I have been in survival mode my whole life, and I pretty much figured out at least how to barely get through shit, but I got through it. So, like, learning a different way than my way just didn't make any sense to me. Sometimes it still doesn't. I still want to, like, do what I think is right other than what I know is right because other people have done it. But I learned that there, that my way doesn't work. My best thinking gets me into trouble. And I learned, so much from that fellowship and that group of people. And a lot of what I talk about in my daily life with other people aren't my original thoughts and ideas. They're ideas that these people have shared with me because people share them with them. And that's how it works. We help each other, and that's why I'm here tonight. Through the recovery fellowship, I learned a lot of other things. I learned that I wasn't going to get sober unless I was ready to surrender completely, and I was willing to do it. Like, there were a lot of things I didn't want to do, a lot of things. I didn't want to change my life. I wanted to still be in a bar every day and hang out with all my normal friends, and I just couldn't do those things anymore, not for a while anyway. And I learned how to be honest with myself, myself mostly, but with everyone. Like, I had been kidding myself for so long that I wasn't an alcoholic, that I just had some pretty shitty things happen to me, and if those shitty things happened to you, you'd probably want to drink too. And that's, like, that was my excuse forever. Like, I deserved to be able to be a crazy alcoholic. Like, my life sucked. And I started seeing other people that had gone through hard things like that, and their life didn't suck anymore, and I didn't want mine to suck anymore, so I started to be like, well, I guess I gotta do this. I guess I gotta listen. I guess I gotta be willing to do what these people are telling me is gonna work. And I remember being at my house one day, and it was after one of the times I had taken a bunch of pills, and somehow I managed to not die. And I was sitting out on my deck, and I literally sat down in the sunshine and put my head back, had no idea who or what or where I was talking to, but I just said out loud, I need help. Like, I am going to die if you don't help me. Like, I didn't know who I was talking to. I didn't know if anybody was listening, but something changed that day. And I found some willingness to do some things that I didn't previously want to do. A lot of things. I stopped working in a bar. And I stopped hanging around with the same friends. A lot of things. I was trying to have a relationship with someone, and I couldn't even take care of myself. So I had to end that. My son had to live somewhere else for a while. Like, really, really hard decisions. But at that point, it was a matter of life and death. Like, I was going to die if I didn't finally do these things. So I did them finally. And it worked. I stayed sober. I don't do any of this stuff the right way. I never have. I probably never will. But I do the best I can. And that's all I can do. I've learned. It's funny to me, like, I don't ever really think I was a morally bad person, but my disease made me really not nice. It made me very manipulative. It made me, I was just out for whatever I could get for me. That's all I cared about, was how I was going to get more alcohol, how I was going to hide it from people. And recovery has just made me want to be a good person again. I want to do the right thing, and I want to help other people, and all those things that I couldn't even comprehend before. I've learned a lot about acceptance. I've learned that life is just hard. Like, shitty things happen to every single one of us, but if I have no control over it, then I have to let it go. I have to accept it for what it is, and I have to move on. And if I learned anything, it's that if I don't pick up a drink, everything is going to be okay. I'm going to figure it out. And it's not going to be alone. It's going to be with all of you, helping me and supporting me. The other thing, there's so many things that I've learned. I just kind of made a list. But I thought I had to be perfect my whole life. And I know I can't possibly be, but I don't want to be anymore. I just want to be a good woman. I want to help other people, and I want to do my best. And if I mess it up, if I hurt someone, I apologize. At the end of the day, I've learned to just kind of look at my day. What did I do? What did I not do? Like, who do I owe an apology to? And then I make it right, and then I let it go. That's what I've learned. Like, I can't hold on to guilt. I can't hold on to shame. Like, those things kept me drinking for years, especially to do with my family. Like, alcoholism is not just for me, it's for my whole family. And I didn't know that. Like, my family had suffered so much. And it sounds terrible, but at the time, I didn't even care. I didn't see it, I didn't want to see it. I didn't care. All I wanted to do was drink, and the next time I could drink, and how I was gonna get it. And, you know, I'm going to be cleaning that stuff up probably forever. My son and I, we, first of all, pardon my language, but he's pretty fucking awesome. And he's finding his way, but I love that kid. And he's not here today. That's okay. He had to say some pretty horrible things. And kind of like his mom, he thinks he's fine, and he doesn't want to deal with any of that stuff. But when this came up, he just couldn't be here. You know, it's still too raw for him. And that's all right. I'm okay with that. But our interactions are much different now. But when we get in the thick of it, we're right back where we, like when I was drinking. Like, we're still learning how to communicate in a somewhat normal way. Like, it's gonna take a long time. As far as my friends and my other family, like, I've just been so lucky. Like, my drinking friends disappeared. No loss there. But, like, I've gained so many amazing people. A lot of them through this recovery fellowship, and a lot of people from my job, like, I'm so thankful for. And, like, who has their ex-husband as one of their best friends? Like, that doesn't usually happen in life, and I'm lucky enough that I can say that. And I'm just so grateful. I know I'm jumping all over. Can you tell? I'm a little nervous. So I guess the other things I wanted to mention were just, like, doing the next right thing. If something comes up and it's hard and I don't know what I'm going to do to get through it, if I just do the next right thing, which can be tying my shoes, can be going to work, can be washing the dishes, if I just do one next right thing after another and I don't pick up a drink, it's all good. It's going to be okay. And I know that because I've done it a little bit now. I don't have to just believe it. The other big thing I just want to talk about, and actually I'm going to be wrapping it up, is gratitude. I didn't even know that word. Like, of course I'd heard the word, but it was not certainly in my vocabulary. And my recovery fellowship has taught me to always, always, always be grateful. Even on the really, really hard days, especially on the really, really hard days, to look around and see all the things that I have to be grateful for. And some days that's harder than others, and some days it's really, really easy. And anybody that knows me knows that I'm pretty much annoyingly happy, and I'm just positive, and life is good. And when I have an off day, I think about what I have to be grateful for. And most days, I could write a really, really long list, and that's only due to being sober today. So I guess I don't know anyone, a lot of you here,
thank you for coming. But if you're struggling, or you know someone that's struggling, or someone in your life is struggling, just please know that there is a way out, that there is hope, that that person doesn't have to live that way. You don't have to live that way. And if I can do this, like, I wanted to die. I prayed every night when I laid down, please God, don't let me wake up, because I can't live this life anymore. If I can come out of that and have this incredible love for my life today, then anybody can do it. In fact, anybody can do anything. Quit smoking, quit whatever. Stop eating peanut butter. I don't know, whatever it is. You can do it. If I can stop drinking, it's possible. I know it in my heart. But you have to be willing to be honest, humble enough to ask for help, and willing to do the hard stuff. You know, and you're not going to do it. At least I didn't do it until I was beat down enough to say, okay, I surrender. I give up. I'm going to lose my life, and I can't. I need help. Okay, so I didn't die for that. I just wanted to thank a couple of people, and then there are a couple of minutes if people want to ask any questions. I don't know if I'll have answers, but, and then I certainly want to say that if you're not comfortable talking in front of the group, then please don't hesitate to reach out to me after. I'm more than happy to give my phone number out. If anyone needs to chat, I'm happy anytime to do that. I want to first thank Rhonda. Rhonda and I met when I worked at High Speed Checkwear, and I think it's funny that those jokers didn't even know that I was going through all this shit. I wasn't coming to work. I was, like, coming late. I wasn't drinking at work. Like, I would have gotten there. I did get there, actually, but not there. But we obviously don't work there anymore, but she approached me about this a few months ago, and man, you want to talk about an awesome lady. Like, she does it all, and through all of that, she's supported me always, and I'm so honored that you gave me this opportunity to share my story and hopefully help someone. I want to thank all of you. I know you probably didn't have on the top of your list to come hear someone talk about being a drunk, but I appreciate the fact that you love me enough to come and listen and support me. That really means a lot. And I have to, without crying, thank John, one of my very best friends. He's gone above and beyond to support me through this and everything. And I'm just so blessed that he didn't completely walk away from me. So lastly, I just wanted to read, I like poetry, and I like the outdoors. So I thought I'd read this poem that I read a while ago that really connected with me, and I hope you'll listen and like it. It's called The Oak Tree. A mighty wind blew night and day. It stole the oak tree's leaves away, then snapped its boughs and pulled its bark until the oak was tired and stark. But still the oak tree held its ground while other trees fell all around. The weary wind gave up and spoke, how can you still be standing, oak? The oak tree said, I know that you can break each branch of mine in two, carry every leaf away, shake my limbs, and make me sway. But I have roots stretched in the earth, growing stronger since my birth. You'll never touch them, for you see, they are the deepest part of me. Until today, I wasn't sure of just how much I could endure. But now I found, with thanks to you, I'm stronger than I ever knew. Thank you. Hold it in front of your face so you can be heard.
you too.
Steph, thank you so much for sharing your story. It was incredible and really enlightening. What I'm wondering, though, is how do you deal with social events now? Even people's weddings or just going to people's parties, or what do you wish that people would acknowledge when you're going to come?
I don't want anybody to worry about me. Like, it's my decision, and it's my job to know whether I'm in spiritual condition enough to be able to go. And what I've learned is that even if it's something important like a wedding that I feel like I have to be at, I don't have to be at it if I'm not in a good place in my head. And sometimes that might hurt people. But again, it comes down to being a matter of life and death for me, so that has to be first. I should also say that I kind of had to hibernate the first year and not be around it, and because it was just obviously a big trigger to even be around anyone that was drinking. And fortunately for me, the obsession, like, I don't even really think about drinking much anymore, and I worked back in the restaurant that I worked in before my drinking got out of hand. Obviously, most of you probably know that. But, and I don't struggle with that like you might think, for the most part. But I have to know, I have to know my limitations. Like, when I schedule myself there, I don't spend a lot of time there late at night, because I know that's when things tend to get crazy. And I don't want to drink, but I just get irritable and anxious. So I just don't go anywhere if I'm not feeling it. And I guess the big thing is that we always think we have to do things, you know, especially when it comes to our family. And I don't have to do that. If I'm not comfortable, I don't go. And for the most part now, I went to an event last weekend where people were drinking, and I had a great time. But if I had had a bad day, I wouldn't have gone. So sorry, that was a way long-winded answer, but I hope that answers it. Thank you for coming. Don't
John,
be shy.
John, back corner.
Oh, jog, Johnny. Oh.
There are seats up front.
Can you hear me?
I can. Can you hear me?
Very strong, and you're beautiful, and you should move forward in your life in a positive way for you and yourself.
Thank you so much. Thanks for coming. I really appreciate it. She wants to know what I think the hardest part of my recovery was. I guess I'm going to start by saying that I still have to work on this every single day. Like, I just didn't stop drinking and then I'm all better. And then I don't have to do anything anymore. I didn't really say that. And recovery is like being a diabetic. Like, I have to take medicine every day. And I have to take care of myself and do the things that I know make me feel better. And so I should say that first. It's definitely, like, I'm going to be an alcoholic for the rest of my life. Like, I don't get a free pass now. I have to work at it every single day. Probably the hardest part for me was initially guilt and shame that kept me from being able to stop. I had, once I would sober up, I would have such horrible, overwhelming guilt, mainly to do with my son and my husband, and I would just want to check out from that, just like everything else. I didn't want to feel how horrible I felt, so it was like a vicious cycle that I just couldn't get out of. So, I guess that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, Misty.
Thanks. Does your son drink?
Oh, I gotta be careful how I answer. Not very much. And it's not that he's anti-drinking. I'm not anti-drinking. But he quite often makes this comment, and it's normally to do with me and food, which is my new problem. Just don't eat it, Mom. And so he seems so far to be able to have that magic ability to just have one, and I don't have that. And I always keep an eye on it, like he'll buy a six-pack and I'll be like, I'm checking that in the morning. And it's never completely gone. There's usually like one or two, and I'm like, that's so weird. Like, who doesn't drink the whole thing? Like, come on. I'd be going to the store and buying more. Like, it just doesn't make any sense. So I just pray to God that that doesn't change, because at his age, I didn't consider myself having a drinking problem either, and it definitely turned into one, so. Not currently. Jamie. Sorry, Teddy first.
Thank you, Stephanie. Great job. Part of the reason I wanted to come here is because I haven't had a drink since August.
Yes.
Because I knew that I had a problem.
Yay!
I'm 34 now. I've got hopefully a long life to live, a happy life. And I was very depressed, and you know, alcohol kind of plays tricks on me. And it makes you think you don't have a problem, but when so many things happen and you're cleaning up messes all the time, you gotta realize that you do. And my advice for anybody that has a problem is to just take a break and replace something bad with something good. And that's what I think I've done. And I'm happy now, I'm happier. You know, alcohol, I think, is depressant, so you could wean yourself off of it, get a support system, whatever you can do, it's great, and really happy to hear you, and I'm not going to say I've never been drinking again, but I'm happier without booze in my life, so thank you, everybody, appreciate it.
Thank you. I think Jamie was there. No, Jamie Jensen.
Oh, Jamie Jensen behind me. Hey, Beth, thank you so much. I can't believe how brave you are.
Aww,
one of the things you touched on is something close to my heart, and that's where a lot of pain came from your childhood with sexual assault. I work with sexual assault victims in the community, and I want to know a little bit more about how you battled that with your sobriety.
Well, that was something that I reluctantly had to get outside help for, outside of my recovery fellowship. And I didn't want to do that for a really long time. But I've learned that the only way past hard things is through hard things. So for a couple of years, I went to an outside therapist that focused on sexual assault, but also had some background in alcoholism. So she was able to help me with both. I didn't stop drinking during that time. I mean, I didn't go there drunk, but we made a lot of progress that way. But more importantly for me, what's helped is just talking to other women. Like, that's really where I heal, knowing that I'm not alone, that those things happen to, unfortunately, a lot of people, men and women. And the more I talk about it, because I talk about it still all the time now with other friends in recovery, and the more I talk about it, the less power it has over me. And it might sound weird, but the actual abuse part, I think, was less damaging to me than the fact that no one helped. Like, that's really, really what had an impact on me and what kind of person I was and how I looked at myself, which I had a very low level of what I was and who I was. So, I mean, I had to do a lot of work, or a lot of really hard work, but it paid off. So,
thank you for sharing.
Thanks. Thank you for coming.
John, there's one behind you that way. I definitely know I don't need another phone, but that's all right. I was just curious about the warning signs. You said you drink all week, and then you would go to work, and you'd be sober, and then you drink on the weekends, and what about the warning signs? Because you put on this facade for everyone. What do we need to be looking for in our friends and in our family members that maybe you know better than those of us that aren't going through this? What are the signs that I should be looking for?
Well, first of all, I'm going to say that I don't have all the answers. All I have is my own experience and what I did. And very sneaky, manipulative behavior. I was hiding it all the time. I was always lying about how much, where. And then just when I did, I had no... Once I had one drink, I had no choice over how many more I was going to have. And it was usually going to be all of it. Like, as much as there was, that's how much I would drink. And I would do it until I passed out. So, anybody that's excessive, I would say, anyone that doesn't have the ability to just have one and then stop. But then, when it progressed for me, it was more all the sneaking and hiding. And, that was a full-time job. That I wasn't doing well, trying to hide it from the people that I loved. And I wasn't doing it well, but I thought it was. I hope that helps.
My other question was, who called you out? Like, who's been there and said, they've seen you through this, they're the ones that called you out. Like, I know you're my own personal demon. I have that one person that knows me good, bad, ugly, and it hasn't, when you said there's no judgment.
Mm-hmm. Well, when I initially was trying to stop, it was definitely my family. Like, I wasn't kidding them for anything. Like, they knew exactly what was going on. But unfortunately, they were too close to me and loved me, and I was really able to convince them that for a long time anyway, that I was doing better than I was. And then when I got introduced to the fellowship, I didn't really have to, I guess you go in there and you hear other people and you're just honest. But you have to be ready to get to that point. I guess I didn't have, other than my family, because at the end of my drinking, I pushed every single person away. I was completely alone. I didn't have anybody. I was literally in my bed alone drinking. Nobody wanted to be around me. And if I did drink with someone, I found people that drank just as crazy as I did. So they certainly weren't going to say anything to me. But my son and my husband said things regularly, and I just didn't want to hear it. So I guess my advice there would be tough love. It's really hard to not enable someone that you love when it comes to addiction. But it's the best thing you can do for them if you want to save their life.
Thank you.
Here and then back there. You got one here, John, and then there's one in the yellow hat.
Probably don't need a microphone. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. I know it's not a good thing you went through this because it's like really horrible, but I think maybe you were put on this world for a reason. Maybe to tell your story and help other people around here and influence them, because I know you're probably influencing all these people in a positive way, even me. So,
I think that the people that know me really well know that my mom was a pretty freaking amazing lady, and she had a really awful illness for 30 or 35 years and was the happiest, most positive person I ever knew in my whole life, and I always wanted to be more like her, and I couldn't figure out why I wasn't. But before she passed away, through my struggles, I remember so many times saying to her, like, why is this my life? Like, why did I have to go through all these things? Why am I an alcoholic? And every single time she told me the same exact thing. And she said, someday you're going to help other people. You know, so like, I feel like it's my responsibility now to do hard stuff like this, because who knows who's listening? Who knows who's suffering that might hear one little tiny thing that my crazy head says that they might be, wow, like, I went through that, and I thought I was alone, and I'm not. And if that lady can get sober,
then damn it, so can I. So it's just important. Like, I've learned that it's really important. If I want to stay sober, I got to help other people try to stay sober. So thanks. Thanks for coming.
I think you're doing this on purpose.
I do talk to her all the time now. I know she's here.
She's saying you're doing good.
Yeah.
During your early sobriety, which falls, in your opinion, what was the same influence committing thousands of times?
Say that one more time.
I said, in your opinion, during early sobriety, what was the same?
It's self-explanatory for me. If I have one, there's not enough after that. If I just don't have the first one, I can't get drunk, and I'm good. But once I have the first one, it's all over. I'm going to do as much as possible, and I'm going to die. It's just the way it is. Does that answer your question?
Yep.
Okay. Thanks for coming.
I want to say thank you for sharing, and I know how you feel because I have a little bit of anxiety too. But I wanted to ask you, if you could go back to before you started drinking, what would you tell yourself? Besides the obvious, like, don't drink.
I guess I would just want to be more honest with myself. Like, I was really good at hiding things, and I would just say, be honest, so I could see what was really going on with me the whole time. I was so clueless. I had no idea what was really going on that I had a drinking problem. I knew I drank a little bit too much, but I had no idea that I was an alcoholic. I didn't know what an alcoholic was. I've never met one. So I guess I would just tell myself to really take an honest look at myself and what's going on here. Thanks.
Is everybody back done?
I'm celebrating 16 months being a recovering alcoholic.
Yay!
It can happen. There's a long line of it in my family, and one day I just said, it is enough. And I'm proud of you. Good job.
Thank you for coming. Everybody good? So again, thank you so much for coming. I don't even know how to thank you. I really appreciate it. I feel not alone these days. I feel very loved and supported, and that's freaking amazing. So thanks.